Hello, I'm happy to welcome you to the second lecture of the part two of radiation protection. In this lecture, we will discuss a little more about shielding considerations for bunkers, in which we will be able to look at high energy bunkers and also HDR bunker. Scope of the lecture would be for the student to understand the room design for external beam facility for high energy machines, that is beyond 10 MV, to learn different types of barriers and barrier thickness, particularly for laminated barriers, to learn barrier thickness calculation for neutron capture gamma rays and photon neutrons which happen beyond 10 MV, to learn barrier thickness calculation for HDR brachytherapy room. The shielding calculation methods used for the scattered photons of low energy beams could very well be adapted for high energy photons also. However, there are two things you will have to consider for high energy photons. One is the photoneutrons produced due to interaction of the primary photon with the heavy metals in the treatment head of the linear accelerator. Second thing is these neutrons, photoneutrons, when they pass through the concrete barriers, they produce neutron capture gamma rays. And the minimum energy of this neutron capture gamma rays is 3.6 MeV. The barrier that we make should take into account the photoneutrons as well as the neutron capture gamma rays. Please note the minimum energy of the neutron capture gamma rays is 3.6 MeV. Next, we will look at laminated barriers for high energy photons. When space becomes an issue or a constraint, in order to reduce the actual barrier thickness, what one could do is to use metal like steel or lead in the regular concrete. In such cases, the total transmission factor is the product of individual material transmission factors. So the total transmission BT would be B concrete into B lead into B steel, in case you have steel also there, right? One thing we have to be very careful is whenever you have a metal here, the metal could become a source of neutrons. So the concrete behind the metal should be able to absorb those neutrons. Therefore, if it is wrongly constructed, the metal shield could become a source of photoneutrons. One has to be careful about that. The estimation of neutron dose from a laminated barrier could be arrived at by using this equation, where Hn is the neutron dose equivalent per week measured in sievert. D0 is the X-ray absorbed dose per week at the isocenter in gray per week, that is the primary beam absorbed dose. R is the neutron production coefficient measured in microsievert per centigrade per beam in meter square. So R is the neutron production coefficient, which is measured in microsievert per centigrade per beam in an area of meter square, right? And next is the F max, that is the maximum field size at isocenter. Tm and T1 are the metal slab and the first concrete slab thickness respectively. TVLX and TVLN, which are here, are the 10th value layers in concrete for X-ray and neutron beams respectively. TVLX is the 10th value layer for X-rays and TVLN is the 10th value layer for neutron beam. Point 3 here is the distance from the outer surface of the barrier to the point of measurement or occupancy. You remember in the first lecture I said normally the occupancy is calculated 30 centimeters from the barrier. It is not close to the barrier. We normally say 30 centimeter from the barrier. So that is the 0.3 factor. For 18 MV photons, the measured neutron production coefficient, that is the R, is 19 microsievert per centigrade per meter square for lead and 1.7 microsievert per centigrade per meter square for steel. This means the neutron production is much more in the case of lead when the photons interact than in steel. And you can also note that the neutron production coefficient R is 3.5 microsievert per centigrade per meter square for lead for 15 MV compared to 19 microsievert per centigrade per meter square for 18 MV. The 10th valley layer for neutron is measured to be 45 gram per centimeter square. If you are using concrete, a value of 25 centimeter would be a conservatively safe estimate as neutron capture gamma rays is also implicitly considered. A value of 25 centimeter will hold good for both regular concrete as well as for heavy concrete. Because for neutron attenuation, it is the hydrogen content that is important, and it will be the same whether you use a regular concrete or a heavy concrete. The total dose equivalent for laminated barriers will have to be determined. While determining this, you need to remember two things. That is, the gamma rays produced by neutron capture in concrete and gamma rays produced by de-excitation after they undergo photo-neutron interaction and left in an excited state. It has been estimated that if you use steel and concrete laminates, that is using steel in concrete, at 15 and 18 MV photon beam energies, the calculated transmitted X-ray dose equivalent component, HDR, if you multiply that by 2.7, would yield a conservatively safe estimate of photon dose equivalent from X-ray plus gamma rays in CVET. Therefore, your H total, that is the dose equivalent total in a laminated barrier, is the HN, that is the dose equivalent by neutron, plus HPHTR, which is the photon dose equivalent from X-ray plus gamma rays. This can be written as HN plus 2.7 HTR, that is 2.7 times the transmitted X-ray dose equivalent component. HTR is estimated by B primary, that is the primary barrier transmission factor, by replacing the H by HTR. If the H total is larger than H, the calculation is iterated to reduce HTR and thus H total to attain the required shielding goal. Now we will move on to door and maze for high energy accelerators. We have learned that the average energy of neutron capture gamma rays from concrete is 3.6 MeV, which is higher than the scattered photon energy. Therefore, a maze or a door that provides sufficient shielding for the neutron capture gamma rays will also be adequate for scattered radiation, scattered photon, particularly when the maze length is larger than 2.5 meters. The door shielding in high energy room is mainly for neutron capture gamma rays and photoneutrons. Please note the neutron capture gamma rays and photoneutrons are important for high energy photons in calculation of door shielding. One has to determine the dose equivalent due to neutron capture gamma rays. That is, the dose equivalent from neutron captured gamma rays, which is represented by H5 at the outside maze entrance, that is at this point, per unit dose of X-rays here at the isocenter. And that is given by the equation H5 is equal to K5A 10 power minus D2 by TVD, where K is the ratio of the neutron captured gamma ray dose equivalent to the total neutron fluence at the location A. At this point, phi A is the total neutron fluence per meter square at location A, again at this point, per unit absorbed dose of gray at the isocenter. For unit absorbed dose, the total neutron fluence at this point per meter square. D2 is the distance from this point to the door. TBD is the 10th value distance, which is 5.4 meters for X-ray beams of 18 to 25 MV and 3.9 meters for 15 MV X-ray beams. In order to determine the dose equivalent due to neutron capture gamma rays at the maze entrance, that is at this point, one has to know the total neutron fluence at the inside maze entrance per unit absorbed dose of X-rays at the isocenter. And this is denoted by the letter phi A. Phi A, which is the total neutron fluence at the inside maze entrance A per unit absorbed dose of X-rays at the isocenter, is provided by beta Qn by 4 pi D1 square plus 5.4 beta Qn by 2 pi SR plus 1.3 Qn divided by 2 pi SR. In this, beta is the transmission factor for neutrons that could penetrate the head shielding. And the beta is equal to 1 for lead and 0.85 for tungsten head shielding. This means for lead, you get more neutrons than for tungsten. D1 is the distance from the isocenter to the point A. This distance is this D1. Qn is the neutron source strength in neutrons emitted from the accelerator head per ray of X-ray absorbed dose at the isocenter. Qn is also the neutron source strength in neutrons emitted from the accelerator head per unit absorbed dose of X-rays at the isocenter. SR is the total surface area of the treatment room. The value of Qn is provided in the table in the appendix, which we will see in the next slide. This is the neutron source strength emitted from the accelerator head, which is denoted by Qn for various linear accelerators such as Varian, Elekta, Siemens, and GE for various energies are provided in table 9 in the appendix of NCRP 151. So you can take the value of Qn from this. Once you know Qn, you can calculate phi A. Once you know the phi A, you can calculate the H phi. Once you have calculated this H phi, then you can calculate the weekly dose equivalent at the door. H phi is the dose equivalent at the door, but you need to determine weekly dose equivalent at the door, which is HCG, just by the neutron capture gamma rays. The weekly dose equivalent at the door due to neutron capture gamma rays, which is HCG, is the product of the workload of leakage, that is the leakage workload WL, into the dose equivalent at the outer maze entrance, which is H5. H5 is the neutron capture gamma ray dose equivalent at the outer maze entrance, and WL is the leakage workload. So you have now determined HCG, which is the weekly dose equivalent at the door due to neutron capture gamma rays. We discussed that for high energy linear accelerators, apart from scatter radiation, you need to consider two other things, mainly because of the neutron production. One is the neutron capture gamma radiation, which we discussed. The second thing is the neutron itself, the dose equivalent at the maze entrance due to the neutron itself. Therefore, for medical accelerator operating above 10 MV, the dose shielding should consider the neutrons as well as the photon doses. The neutron dose equivalent at the maze entrance varies a bit, but is largely unaffected by the collimator setting. Maximum neutron fluence here is obtained when the collimator is closed. This is because it is expected that the photoneutrons are produced when the X-rays interact with the material in the collimator or the treatment head. The neutron field in the maze is also a function of the gantry angle and the location of the target rotational plane in the treatment room. The neutron dose equivalent at the maze dose was found to vary approximately by a factor of 2 as the gantry angle was changed. The neutron dose equivalent at the maze dose is determined using an analytical approach. It is based on an analytical approach. It uses a concept called the 10th value distance, which I discussed earlier also. The 10th value distance for the falloff of thermal neutron fluences through the mazes and large ducts. The 10th value distance for neutron, you can roughly say, is equal to 3 times the square root of the product of height times the width of the opening. You have an opening in the maze, it has a height and a width. You take the product and it is roughly 3 times the square root of this product. Each additional leg in the opening decreases the fluence roughly by another threefold. This is because it doesn't follow like X-rays. You know, the neutrons are like bouncing ball technique. If you go one more opening, it decreases the fluence roughly by another threefold. An earliest technique for evaluating the neutron fluence at the maze entry was given by Kersey. He gave an analytical approach for it. And the original equation had to be modified. That is because the ratio of the neutron dose equivalent calculated with the use of Kersey's method varied from 0.82 to 2.3 for 13 different accelerators. Therefore, McGinley and Hoffman modified it slightly to get a better value of the neutron dose equivalent. Subsequently, Wu and McGinley further refined the equation to account for rooms with non-standard surface areas or mazes with exceptional width or length. So they went further and modified the equation. This is the modified Kersey's method. And here, this equation will provide you the neutron dose equivalent at the door. This neutron dose equivalent is measured in sievert per neutron meter square. And it is measured at the entrance per unit dose of X-rays at the isocenter, always per unit dose of X-rays at the isocenter. And this phi A is the neutron fluence per unit absorbed dose of photons at the isocenter. I hope you remember this. We use the same phi A for neutron capture gamma ray calculation also. And S0 by S1 is the ratio of the inner maze entrance cross-sectional area to the cross-sectional area along the maze wall. At the inner maze entrance, you have a cross-sectional area S0. And at the maze, you have a cross-sectional area S1. So the ratio of that is S0 by S1. 10th value distance, you know, I explained you what is 10th value distance and how approximately you can calculate the 10th value distance. And that is what is given here. But this modified equation has a slightly different value. If you remember, I said the 10th value distance is approximately 3 times the square root of the product of the length and the height, width and the height. So which is actually S1. And it's 2.0 times, 6 times of the square root it's given here, not 3 times. So there is a slight modification to the value. 2.06 times the square root of that area, which is the height and the width. The weekly dose equivalent at the door, now you know what is the dose, neutron dose equivalent at the door, you have to calculate the weekly dose equivalent. Weekly dose equivalent is equal to WL, which is the weekly leakage radiation workload, multiplied by the neutron dose equivalent at the door. This is the same thing we did for the neutron capture gamma rays also, HCG. If you remember, we multiplied by the WL. Now that you have determined the weekly dose equivalent for neutron capture gamma ray and for the neutron, and if you remember in the previous lecture, we discussed about the dose equivalent at the door due to scatter from the wall, scatter from the patient, scatter of leakage radiation, and transmission of leakage radiation. And we added all that and said H total. So now that you know H total, HCG due to neutron capture gamma rays, and HN due to neutrons, if you add all this, you get the total dose equivalent at the mace door. For most maces where energies about 10 MV are used, H total is an order of magnitude smaller than the sum of these two. Because I said this energy itself is 3.6 MeV average, and you have neutron also. So this will be a very small fraction, and it could be neglected, particularly if it is a very long maze. Therefore, at high energy, you need to consider photoneutrons and neutron capture gamma rays for door shielding. The average energy of the neutron capture gamma rays, as I mentioned, is 3.6 MeV, and it could go even as high as 10 MeV if the maze is very short. Thus, a TVL of 6.1 centimeter may be required as per NCRP 1984. The average neutron energy at the maze is reported to be 100 keV with a TVL in polythene of 4.5 centimeter. If you use borated polythene, it's supposed to be less effective for fast neutrons, but more effective in the case of thermal neutrons. The 10th valley layer for borated polythene is about 3.8 centimeters for 2 MeV neutrons and 1.2 centimeter for thermal neutron. A safe recommendation is that a TVL of 4.5 centimeter can be used for calculating the BPE thickness, that is the borated polyethylene thickness. There is something more to door shielding. If the maze length is 8 meter or more, the door shielding would require 0.6 to 1.2 centimeter of lead and 2 to 4 centimeter of BPE here. When lead and BPE are used, please note how you should arrange it. The arrangement should be lead, BPE, and then lead. The idea is the lead on the source side reduces the energy of the neutron by inelastic scattering, and thus the BPE is more effective in neutron shielding. It makes it like a thermal neutron, and then BPE is very effective in shielding the thermal neutrons. The lead on the outside of the BPE is supposed to attenuate the neutron capture gamma rays of about 478 keV or so. The outer lead may not be required if you have a very long maze. When you use direct shielding door like this, where you have the door directly in the maze, there is an issue. The issue is, if you look at this carefully, the ray A passes through the entire concrete. Let me say the concrete thickness is 104 centimeters. It passes through the entire 104 centimeters. The ray C passes through lead and BPE, and it also goes through almost the entire attenuation length that it has to go through. But the ray B goes through only part of the distance that it has to pass through. Let me say in this case, approximately it goes through 41 centimeters of 104 centimeters it's supposed to be going through. So this is an issue. To solve this issue, there are two things you can do. One is you extend this door further, right? You increase it. Or you can have additional shielding here. You increase lead and BPE to compensate for this lead and BPE for the ray B. So these are two ways you can solve this problem. We will look at some other interesting concepts. One is the photon sky shine. Radiation facilities that had very little shielding on the ceiling had this problem of sky shine. Those days they used to leave it like that, thinking there is nothing above, so don't worry about it, no floors above. But what could happen is there could be a scatter in the air and which could reach the ground level. This stray radiation is referred to as the sky shine. You should be able to calculate this using this formula. However, nowadays people don't leave that, you know, with little shielding, they do a proper shielding. This is not a very serious issue. Similarly, we have a problem of ground shine. The ground shine is possible when you have a very thin door here. If the door is very thin, what happens is From the isocenter, the radiation hits the floor and the neutrons will be absorbed in the concrete, floor concrete, but the X-rays could escape. So this is a possibility. To avoid that, one may introduce lead here to attenuate the X-rays that can pass through the other side of the bunker. Let us now look at some special procedures. Let us look at the workload for total body radiation. The workload, that is the gray per week at 1 meter for TBI, is usually higher than the conventional radiotherapy treatment for the same unit absorbed dose at the patient. This is because you will be treating the patient at an extended distance. The distance will be quite away from the isocenter. The TBI workload is the absorbed dose at 1 meter. And therefore is the product of the weekly total TBI absorbed dose to the patient and the square of the TBI treatment distance. For example, you are treating at 3 meters, it is the square of the treatment distance into the weekly absorbed dose at 1 meter. Indirectly, you are applying the inverse square correction. In the case of TBI, the patient is usually positioned close to the primary barrier instead of the isocenter. Therefore, the effect of scattered radiation at the room entrance need to be considered. You have to consider that. Distinct workload needs to be determined for TBI primary barrier radiation and the leakage radiation contribution to the secondary barrier. For example, at an average, you do one TBI patient is treated per week with 12 gray at a location of 4 meters from the target. The TBI irradiation increases the workload at 1 meter by 192 gray per week. If you just calculate, as I said in the previous slide, this will be in addition to the normal workload of 300 gray per week at 1 meter. We will look at it a little more closely. Let us look at the use factor for TBI. The use factor for primary wall for conventional treatment will be 0.21. Normally we say 0.25, here it is given as 0.21, that's fine. For TBI, the use factor will be 1 as the beam is always directed towards one primary wall for TBI. The beam is always towards that direction, so the particular primary wall will have a use factor of 1 for the TBI. If you are calculating the workload, that is, you have to add the conventional workload and the TBI workload. The conventional workload, if you assume 300 gray per week and multiply by its use factor 0.21, for TBI workload, assuming there is only one patient a week, it will be 192 into use factor of 1. It will be 255 gray per week. This is also the workload that you should use for determination of the scattered radiation from the TBI barrier and TBI patients. Similarly, the leakage workload for all secondary barriers will be 300 plus 192. When you talk about leakage radiation, you have to take all directions. So it will be the total conventional workload plus the TBI workload, which will be 492 gray per week at 1 meter. For TBI, the maze entrance calculation has to be slightly different. If you remember, when we did the maze entrance calculation, we looked at four things. One is the wall scattered radiation, head leakage scattered radiation, patient scattered radiation, and also looked at leakage radiation transmission through the inner maze wall. We had four factors to calculate the dose equivalent. And then we had the H total. But if you are having TBI, there are two things you will have to have. One is for conventional treatment, which is isocentric treatments, where you can call it the dose equivalent from patient scatter for isocentric treatment, dose equivalent for patient scatter for TBI treatment. So this has to be added for patient scatter alone, for the patient scatter radiation when you do TBI maze calculation. This is the HPS-ISO and HPS-TBI, or the dose equivalent for conventional patient scattered and TBI patient scattered treatments respectively. Let us look at another special procedure, which is intensity modulated radiotherapy, IMRT. I did make a mention about this earlier, and I said when you plan to treat IMRT in that particular bunker, you need to consider that the leakage radiation will be higher and a factor of 10 has to be used for leakage workload. However, NCRP has given you a method to actually determine the IMRT factor. This is because when you treat with IMRT to deliver the same dose to isocenter, you will be using much more MU or BMON time than the conventional treatment. Therefore, an IMRT factor is defined, and the IMRT factor is the ratio of MU-IMRT to MU-conventional per unit absorbed dose to patient. Please remember, you need to include QA requirements also when you do this calculation. Let us say, how do you do this? MU-IMRT, if you want to calculate, it is MUI by D pre I. What is MUI? MUI, you take like 20 patients and see what is the MU you deliver, a sample number of patients. It could be 20 or 25. And what is the dose delivered? That is in the denominator. So you get MU per unit dose. This is referred to as the MU-IMRT. Similarly, you calculate MU conventional to deliver an absorbed dose to 10 centimeter in fan term for SAD of 100. This is MU conventional. You take the ratio of MU IMRT divided by MU conventional, you get IMRT factor. Naturally, MU IMRT will be much higher than the MU conventional. Therefore, you will get an IMRT factor of somewhere around 10 to 12. When you do IMRT, the absorbed dose to the patient is the same like a conventional treatment. Therefore, increase in IMRT MU is not going to significantly affect the workload for the primary barrier or even for the patient scattered or wall scattered radiation components of the secondary barrier. What will change in the case of IMRT is the workload for calculation of leakage radiation, because the BMON time is larger, so the leakage radiation from the head is larger. That is where you have to use the IMRT factor. You don't need to use it for your workload for the primary barrier. Only when you calculate the leakage radiation workload, you need to use the IMRT factor. Let us now see how you include the special procedures in your shielding calculation. For example, in the primary barrier calculation, you need to account for the workload and use factor for IMRT and TBI. What you do is you take the sum of the products of workload and use factor in your primary barrier calculation. For example, you take the workload and use factor for primary, you have to take the workload conventional, use factor conventional, plus workload IMRT, use factor IMRT, workload TBI, use factor TBI, workload QA, use factor for QA. For workload and use factor for wall scatter, you need to do the same thing because their workload and use factor are involved. For patient or phantom scatter, you can use this where the workload is equal to workload conventional plus workload IMRT, workload QA, etc. So this is how you include the special procedures in your shielding calculation. For leakage radiation, you need to do this. For example, in the case of IMRT, what you will do, the workload for leakage radiation, you include workload for conventional plus workload for IMRT into IMRT factor. Then workload for TBI, and workload for QA, and again the QA factor has to come because you may be doing IMRT QA also. So whenever you add, please remember, for IMRT you have to use the IMRT factor. Even in QA you have to use the QA factor. This is necessary only for leakage radiation shielding consideration. It is not necessary for scatter or for primary. Let us also discuss the bunker designs for special units. For example, let us take tomotherapy. As I said earlier, I'm not going to go into the details for the bunker design for tomotherapy, but I'll give you an overview and try to compare it with the conventional bunker design. In tomotherapy, you mostly treat with IMRT, which means you will be using lot of MUs compared to conventional treatment to deliver the same dose at the isocenter, which means you will have a large IMRT factor C1. Secondly, another interesting thing is the primary shielding barrier for tomotherapy may be 10 times narrower than required for a conventional field size to a linear accelerator. This is because in tomotherapy, you use a narrow field. I think it's about 5 cm or so. Therefore, the primary barrier width will be narrower. However, the primary shielding thickness, barrier shielding thickness, may be 1 TVL larger than that is required for a conventional beam of the same energy. As the dose delivered to the patient is the same in tomotherapy as in conventional LINAC, the secondary shielding barrier requirement for scattered radiation may be the same as a conventional LINAC because the dose delivered is the same. So therefore, the shielding requirement for the secondary barrier may be the same as that for a conventional LINAC. The secondary barrier requirement of a leakage radiation component may be 2 TVLs thicker in the case of tomotherapy. This is because of the large MU used for treatment of whole length of the small beam width. Because you use a large MU, therefore, the leakage, because of the leakage radiation, the secondary barrier requirement may be larger by 2 TVLs. It is likely that these conclusions do not apply to helical tomotherapy. In the case of helical tomotherapy, they have got a lot of inherent shielding, internal shielding. Therefore, it is more efficiently shielded in the helical tomotherapy. In the tomotherapy system, the LINAC is shielded from the sides to reduce the leakage, and a beam stopper is also provided, which is approximately 13 centimeter thick lead, which attenuates the patient transmitted primary radiation. The scatter is also confined to the slice region with small lateral spread. Since tomotherapy uses 6 MV LINAC, there are no neutron consideration. So therefore, the head leakage is the most important component. Because of the IMRT, there is more leakage. So in the tomotherapy, it is the head leakage that you need to worry about maximum. Let us look at another interesting treatment unit, the CyberKnife with a robotic arm. For CyberKnife SRS unit, the average MU factor C1 could be as high as 15. Then the workload depends on two things. One is you could do single fraction SRS or you can do fractionated SRS. So your workload calculation for a week should include both. The primary beam contribution could be a factor of 3 larger than the leakage radiation contribution for CyberKnife. Another important thing for CyberKnife is to get the details of the range of solid angle over which the beam could be pointed. This should be examined with current data from the manufacturer when you plan the bunker design. The primary beam can be pointed at most of the treatment room walls. So most of the treatment room walls become primary walls. Let us now look at the shielding consideration for HDR brachytherapy. HDR brachytherapy could be either by iridium-192 or cobalt-60 source. The maximum activity, if you're using iridium-192, will be 10 curie. And in case you are using cobalt-60, the maximum activity will be 2 curie. These are all welded flexible steel cable, source driven out of the safe through a catheter or transfer tube. Typical room is approximately 60 centimeter concrete if cobalt-60 is used. Before working on the shielding design for HDR brachytherapy, you need to have seen some data with you. These are the prerequisites. For example, which treatment technique will be used in the room? What is the likely number of patients per week or per day or per year? How much radioactivity will be used per treatment for procedure? What nuclide will be used and what is its energy? What is the occupancy of the adjacent room or rooms? Where will sources be stored prior to use and after the removal? The shielding calculation is based on transmission factor B. The transmission factor B is given by dose equivalent or the goal into the distance square divided by workload into occupancy factor. The D is the distance from the source to the point of interest. H is the dose limit or dose equivalent, and T is the occupancy factor. The workload for brachytherapy can be calculated based on the dose delivered per treatment and the number of treatments. The workload is equal to RAKR, which is the reference air Kármán rate, into the activity time into the number of treatments, where A is the total activity used and T is the average duration of the treatment time in hours, and N is the number of treatments per week. Alternatively, you can determine the workload using air Kármán strength. In that case, the workload is equal to air Kármán strength, SK, into the average duration of treatment in hours into number of treatments per week. The air Kármán strength of the source is given in units of U or microgray per hour meter square. Let us now calculate the workload for iridium-192. The activity of iridium-192 for a new source will be 10 curie, which is 370 into 10 power 3 megabecquerels. The reference air Kármán rate constant is 0.111 microgray per hour per megabecquerel meter square. The number of patients, let us assume, to be 25 per week. Average treatment time per patient will be approximately 10 minutes, which is 0.16 hours. Therefore, the workload is equal to 0.111, which is the reference air Kármán rate, 370 to 10 power 3, which is the activity, and 0.16, which is the average treatment time, and 25 is the number of patients. So much gray per week at 1 meter. If you calculate this, it will come to 0.17 gray per week at 1 meter, which we can safely assume to be 0.2 gray per week at 1 meter. Let us do a workload calculation for cobalt-60. The activity we use for cobalt-60 for a new source will be 2 curie, which is 74 into 10 power 3 megabecquerel. The reference air Kármán rate for cobalt, it is 0.306 microgray per hour per megabecquerel meter square. Number of patients, let us assume, to be the same as 25 per week. Average treatment time is, again, let us say, is 10 minutes, which is 0.16 hours. If you calculate the workload, assuming these values for reference air Kármán rate, activity, time, and number of patients, you get approximately 0.094 gray per week at 1 meter, which we can safely assume to be 0.1 gray per week at 1 meter. Let us now see how to calculate the transmission factor for brachytherapy. The transmission factor for brachytherapy is obtained using this equation, B is equal to H d square by W into T. H is the design goal or dose limit. D is the distance from the source to the point of interest. W is the workload, which we calculated in the previous slide. And T is the occupancy factor. You can substitute W using the reference air Kármán rate into activity, time, and N, or you can substitute using air Kármán strength into time into N, where air Kármán strength of the source is given in the units of U or microgray meter square per hour. Let us now try and do the barrier thickness calculation for iridium-192. The first step in barrier thickness calculation is to calculate the barrier transmission factor B. For this, we need to know what is D, what is H, what is W, and what is T. We did calculate the W, and we know the W is equal to 0.2 gray per week or 200 milligray per week. And we know the occupancy factor at this point, let us assume it is 1. And we also know the dose limit at this point. We are calculating here the dose limit at this point or the shielding design goal. H is 0.02 millisievert per week, assuming it is an uncontrolled area. The distance from this point to here is 200 centimeters from here to here, plus 45 centimeter approximately is the wall thickness, and you take a point 30 centimeter from here where the occupancy factor has been assumed. So total distance will be 2.75 meters. If you substitute all this in this equation and calculate the barrier thickness, barrier transmission factor, it will come to 0.000729. Now, you know the barrier transmission factor. The number of 10th value layers needed is equal to log 10 of 1 by barrier transmission factor, which is equal to 3.14. That means you need 3.14 10th value layers for as the shielding barrier thickness here. We know for concrete, the 10th value layer for iridium energy is 13.5 centimeter. Therefore, the barrier thickness will be 3.14 into 13.5, which is 42.4 centimeters, which is approximately, we can take it as 45 centimeter as the wall thickness. Let us now try to do the shielding calculation for a cobalt-60 HDR bunker. As usual, the first thing you have to do is to determine the barrier transmission factor. To determine barrier transmission factor, you need H, which is the shielding design goal, and you know it is 0.202 millisievert per week because it is an uncontrolled area. And D is the distance to the point. From here to the barrier is 200 centimeter. Let us assume the thickness of the wall will be 60 centimeter and your occupancy is 30 centimeter from the wall. So total distance will be 2.9 meters. The occupancy here I assume as 1, and the workload we calculated earlier for cobalt 60 to be about 0.1 gray per week, which is 100 milligray per week. If you apply all this into the barrier transmission factor equation, you get the barrier transmission factor as 0.001682. If you know the barrier transmission factor, then you can find the number of 10th value layers needed using this formula. N is equal to log to the base 10, 1 by barrier transmission factor, which if you calculate will be 2.77 in this case. That is, the number of 10th value layers required will be 2.77. The 10th value layer thickness for cobalt-60 energy for concrete is 20.2 centimeter. If you need 2.77 10th value layers, the thickness of the barrier will be 56 centimeter. You can safely assume it to be 60 centimeter for practical purpose. I would like to acknowledge that the references I used are NCRP report 49, NCRP report 151, and the book on radiation safety in radiation oncology by K.N. Govindarajan, and IAEA safety report series 49 on radiation protection in the design of radiotherapy facilities. Thank you very much for patient listening. Please do the MCQs following this lecture and then move on to the next lecture.